Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J was invited to speak at the Altar Society in Lake Charles on the work and history of the Ruth Institute.
Good morning, everybody, or good afternoon, everybody. It's nice to see you. I'm cleaned up good. You know, I look better now than I normally do at 6:30 in the morning. I can't pull it together. You know, I mean, I get there, but that's like all I can do is I get there. But anyway, I'm over there in the choir with Mr. Jerry Cruz, you know. So if you, you know, have seen me about, that's where I am, over there on the little, you know, the little choir side. And I'm new to Lake Charles. We moved here about a year ago September, so it's been about 15 months or so. And we are refugees from California, as I like to put it, because, you know, it's rather crazy over there, and of course very expensive, and so on. And so we're very happy in Lake Charles. I just want you to know, we're very happy in Lake Charles. My goddaughter lives here, and that's why we chose this particular location to come here. Beverly asked me if I would talk with you all about the Ruth Institute and our mission and what we're doing around the country and really around the world. So I founded the Ruth Institute to promote marriage, to promote lifelong married love. And I did it, at the time that I did it, Proposition 8 was getting underway in California. And I don't know if you remember Proposition 8, but that was the amendment to the California Constitution that said marriage shall be between one man and one woman only. And you've probably all heard of that, right, that happened in California. And you may remember even that we won. So I want to remind you that we won that election, all right? And I was a campaign spokeswoman for that election, and I represented the campaign to the Los Angeles Times and did a lot of debates and interacted with people of a lot of different faiths about the issue of marriage. And I came to find out that many, many people across the religious spectrum agree with what the Catholic Church teaches in the main, you know. And the things they don't agree about, oftentimes, they used to agree about. So, for example, contraception and divorce, right up until 1930, really everybody agreed with the ancient teaching of the Catholic Church, which is that contraception is a serious sin and shouldn't be done, you know. And it was only in 1930 that any Protestant church changed their teaching about that. So I'm just giving you a little background about the Ruth Institute, that I was involved in some very controversial situations in doing that. I've had people come and demonstrate at my talks where I, you know, they were trying to make it so I couldn't talk at University of California, Santa Barbara. I had my very own cheering section, you know, who were there chanting at me and so on. You can see, I took video of it, and you can see it on YouTube. You'll see that I bested them. I'm officially listed as a hate organization by the Southern Poverty Law Center. You didn't know that I'm a hate group. And also, I have been blacklisted by the one of these media groups that monitors how many gay people they have on TV programs. Okay, so I'm a real bad dude. I mean, I think you can see I'm really scary, you know, out there kind of a person. But when the Supreme Court overturned marriage and basically said marriage is whatever we say it is, I mean, that's pretty much what they said. And if you read the decision, it's really no better than that. A lot of legal scholars look at it and think, what the heck? This is so embarrassing. You know, how bad the decision was. Just like Roe v. Wade was badly done, you know. They just had an outcome they wanted. When that happened, we realized that we have to kind of change our tactics a little bit, because many things that are harmful and sinful are going to be legal for the foreseeable future. Just like abortion is going to be legal for the foreseeable future. But it is harmful, it is sinful, and therefore we must continue to speak out against it. But the way we speak out against it may be different once we realize that people are tempted to do all of these harebrained things. So I want to begin by telling you that I'm aware of kind of where you guys are, in the sense that I want to apologize in advance that I don't want to shock you and I don't want to upset you with the things that I'm going to say. But we have to face what's going on out there, all right? So let me just tell you a couple things. In California, a child can have three legal parents on their birth certificate. Now, that's gross, right? They can have three. In California, I woke up one day and discovered I no longer had a husband. Now, nothing had happened to Mr. Morse. Mr. Morse and I are still on good terms, and he was quite alive and everything. But Jerry Brown had removed from the law the terms husband and wife, mother and father, and replaced those terms with partner and parent. Okay? So now when these things happen, and I could go on and on, I could tell you even grosser, you know, really gross things. This is the kind of thing that made us want to leave California, if you can imagine. But here's the thing. A lot of times when we hear things like this, what we want to do is just kind of go like this. You know, it's like, oh, right? You just don't even want to think about it. Why would you need such a law that a child could have three parents? Why would you want to take the word husband and wife out of the law book? You don't even want to think about it, much less go talk about it, right? But what I want you to understand is that the people on the other side, the people who want all these things, they talk about it all the time. They never shut up. They're talking about it constantly, right? And so every time we're going like this, like, get me out of here. I don't want to even think about it. They're moving forward. They are moving forward. And so we have to kind of gear ourselves up to at least do something, right? You may not be doing what I'm doing. Okay, I get that. Not everybody's glutton for punishment. You don't necessarily want to do what I'm doing. But everybody needs to do something because they've got a lot of people, and more importantly, they've got a lot of money promoting the breakdown of the family, really, is what it amounts to. Promoting the breakdown of the family. Well, I could go all the way back to Roe versus Wade and the contraception decisions and, you know, right up till the transgender agenda and all these things that are happening. You know what transgenderism is, right? That's another thing nobody really wants to think about, right? Decent people don't even want to think about it, right? But it's happening. And every one of those movements, at every phase, there have been big foundations and very wealthy people pumping millions of dollars into it to do lobbying and producing papers and, you know, being on TV and doing all of these kinds of things to make these things happen. So all we have two things going for us. Number one, there are a lot of us. There are a lot of people who think what we think. A lot of them voted for Trump. I just read an analysis about the Trump voter, and it said that the social issues were actually very important to the typical Trump voter, including the black Trump voter and the Hispanic Trump voter, of which there were quite a few, more than anybody expected, right? And I can tell you from experience, being out in the field, Hispanic people and African American people are totally on board with man-woman marriage. Right, they are totally, and at Prop 8, they voted for man-woman marriage a lot more than white people did. That's a fact, okay, across the country. So there are a lot of us. There are a lot of us who hold the traditional view. So that's the one thing we have on our side. The other thing we have on our side is truth. Right, we have truth, and we have Jesus himself. His clear teaching about what marriage is supposed to be, what marriage is, and what it is supposed to be. So that's what we... that's what we cling to, is the idea that it is possible, if we will do it, it is possible to create a mass social movement that will confront the problems of family breakdown and that will bless and work on building up the family in a positive manner. There are a lot more of us than there are of them. So if we, you know, kind of all get out there and do our part, we can do something. And we've proven this again and again. Voters have voted in favor of the right things, and the courts have overturned it, right? And the courts is like five guys or nine guys or something like that. But where numbers count, we can succeed. So that's a very important part of what we're doing. So the first thing I would like to do is to just introduce you to the concept, the main concept that we're working with now, which is the concept of the survivors of the sexual revolution. And I want to pass this brochure out. Beverly, would you pass that out and see that everyone gets one of those, perhaps? I don't know if I gave you quite enough here. All right, here you go. Why don't you start those around, okay? The thing which occurred to us is that gay marriage and transgenderism didn't just come out of nowhere. There have been many forms of family breakdown that have taken place before that. And that in order for people to believe that what two guys do together is the same as what a man and a woman do, something has already had to happen to their thought process to get to that point, okay? And so what we have broken it down into is to think about the fact that our culture has already separated sex from marriage and separated sex from babies, right? In our minds, we've already said that having sex without a baby is an entitlement, right? I mean, that's what everybody behaves that way. You guys don't behave that way. You guys know better. But that's what the culture has produced, the idea that it's an entitlement to have sex without a baby. And you don't have to be married to do any of this stuff. Now, the problem with both of those things is, of course, as you all know, sex makes babies. You do know that, right? Okay, good. Because one time I said that in a law school debate. I was at a law school, grown-up people, presumably past middle school, and I said, sex makes babies. And my debate opponent said, no, it doesn't. Oh, really? Says I. What do you mean? And she said, unprotected sex makes babies. You see, that's how they think. Unprotected sex makes babies. That means child is not the result of the conjugal love of the husband and wife. Child is a result of contraceptive failure. That's how their minds work, okay? So that's an important part of saying that marriage can be whatever we say it is, right? Is to say, well, you know, we have sex and nothing bad happens because, well, we just sweep the baby away through abortion. You know, we don't even think about that as being connected. So that's the first thing that's untrue that we've already accepted. And the second thing that's untrue that we've already accepted is the idea that kids don't really need their own moms and dads. But they do. Right? Children really do need their own mothers and fathers. Because if you really believe kids need their own mothers and fathers, you would not be thinking about two men having a child. Because you would get that there had to be a woman somewhere involved here, that somehow they acquired the baby from the mother, and yet the law has to keep that mother away. The law has to deliberately separate the child from one of their parents in order for a same-sex couple to have a baby. That's just a fact, right? For them to have legal rights to the baby, you got to get rid of one of the parents. So what were we thinking? What was everybody thinking when they're saying that this is an okay thing? Well, what they're thinking is kids are resilient. And if their parents are happy, they'll be fine. That's what they were thinking. And if the parents really, really want them, they'll be happy and everything will be fine. That's what we were all thinking, right? Well, if you reflect on that a little bit and reflect on our experience with divorce, you know that that's not true. We've already tried that. We've already tried switching out parents just because the parents feel like it, you know? Now, don't get me wrong. If there's a situation of extreme abuse or infidelity, sometimes people do have to separate. We get that, and the church gets that, right? It's remarriage that we have a problem with. Right, it's remarriage where the problem comes in. But if you have to separate for your safety, well, we don't have any problem with that. But what has happened in modern times is that people divorce for any reason or no reason. They never have to give an account of themselves. And the government takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. That's a fact. That's how it works. And so that means we've been operating on the assumption that divorce and remarriage is all going to be fine. The kids are all going to be fine because, you know, they're so resilient. It'll be fine. And we know from experience and from the teachings of our Lord himself that this is not true. And I like to think, you know, when Jesus told us, the apostles back there, back in Matthew 19, when he told them, it's adultery if you remarry. I tell you, if you divorce and remarry, this is adultery. His apostles were completely freaked out over that, if you remember. You know, they're like, what? This is like way too hard. We can't do that. What are you talking about? You know, kind of thing. But I like to think that Jesus knew how much those kids were going to suffer when their parents separated, when their parents remarried somebody else, and when they had to go from one house to the other, never really being at home in either home, looking at the photos on the wall where their new half-sibling has a picture of herself with her mom and her dad, but there's no picture of me and my mom and dad hanging at my mom's house because she didn't want to see any pictures of my dad. And likewise at my dad's house No picture of my whole family hanging on the wall anyplace. Jesus knew this was going to be very painful. There were going to be a lot of little, seemingly little things like that that were going to add up to be real harmful and a real burden on children. And so what we've decided to do at the Ruth Institute is to quit fooling around with politics and get right down to the spiritual reality that we're dealing with spiritual warfare here and deal with all of these problems of the sexual revolution. Don't just pick out one at a time. Go for the whole shooting match. What the heck? That's why I go to Mass every day. I couldn't possibly do this by myself. I'm not completely crazy. I'm close to completely crazy, but not completely crazy. So what we did is we said to ourselves, who has been harmed by the breakdown of the family and the breakdown of sexual morality? Who has been harmed by it? And we came up with this list in this pamphlet. So if you just open the first page and look down the list, you'll see a whole lot of different kinds of people who've been harmed by the sexual revolution. And right at the top, children of divorce. Right at the top. And then children of unmarried parents. Many of them are going through a lot of the same problems. The reluctantly divorced parent, the reluctantly divorced person. We don't even realize it, but there are many people who would like to stay married, but because of no-fault divorce laws, they can't stay married. They can say, I want to work on the relationship. I want to stay married. I haven't done anything wrong. And that person can be divorced against their will. The government takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. So all these different kinds of people are on this list of people who have been harmed by the sexual revolution. You'll see a little further down the post-abortive woman. You'll see the career woman, the heartbroken career woman. That was me. I thought, well, I'll get tenure at a major university. I'll have a baby after I get tenure, I'll have a baby, and I will have 10 children starting at age 35. You know, and I was actually good at math, right? I mean, you know, right? But a lot of girls are still operating on this kind of idea. And then, of course, if you can only have one child or you have big infertility problems or whatever, that's a much bigger heartbreak than anyone will tell you, right? And we did go through that. That's another whole story I won't go into. But the point is that the gay lifestyle refugees, that's what we call them. We don't even talk about the whole gay lobby. Just that there are some people who experience same-sex attraction who would like to be doing something else other than living the gay lifestyle. They'd like to be doing something else. And they are, all of these people, what they all have in common is that they are socially invisible. You will never see a story in the New York Times about the heartbroken career woman or the post-abortive woman. You'll see that in our publications, right? In Ruth Institute and Gabriel Project and those type of Catholic publications, you'll see people talking about those who have been harmed by some of these things. But some of them you won't even hear in our stuff, right? So this term reluctantly divorced, we invented that term because we felt it was necessary to describe this very, very large social reality out there. So the point is many people have been harmed by this, and what we want to do is to recruit these people, help them heal, and only after that start talking about what are we going to do about public policy. Because right now, a lot of those people are too wounded to participate, right? And they don't want to participate. They're still kind of, you know, dealing with whatever they have to deal with in their lives. And so we're not going to get anywhere unless we confront the reality that many people have been harmed by the sexual revolution. So if you open up the panel, you'll see over here, is this what you were told? And down this big column here are the lies of the sexual revolution. Very first one, kids are resilient. Down a little further, no one ever regrets their hookups. Casual sex is for the refugees from the hookup culture down toward the bottom. Casual sex is harmless as long as you use a condom every time. That is a big lie, right? And I think all, you know, you're mature women, you know that's true. It's not harmless. You've seen many people suffer from it. And perhaps you've suffered yourself in some cases. So our strategy is identifying all of this wreckage, all of these wounded souls, and addressing it instead of sweeping it under the rug and pretending it's not there. We have a couple of programs that we've developed to do this. On our website, we have ruthinstitute.org, which is our website, And there we have a couple of features that where people can go and tell their stories about what happened to them. So, and it's all anonymous. So, you know, and we have people who are children of divorce and talk about what was done to them. And we have people who were somehow participants in the sexual revolution, and they'll talk about what they did. One lady starts off by saying, "I'm ashamed to contribute to this blog because I was one of the people who wrecked a family," right? But that, does that person need healing or what? Right? Can anybody top the Catholic Church in terms of helping people with forgiveness and healing? No, we're the best. You know, we're the best that's ever been in dealing with that. So we developed that blog, and then we've also developed another program. I want to mention to you guys that we have a weekly newsletter. If you'd like to give me your email address, I can add you to that list so you can find out what we're doing, keep track of us, keep track of my movements, and be part of the things that we're doing around here locally. And the thing that we did locally is that a few weeks ago, October 22nd, we put on a program called Healing Family Breakdown. And this is one of the things that we gave the participants. Let me give you a few. Yes, please. Yes, please. You want to pass these around? We held, and this was a half-day retreat called Healing Family Breakdown. It was held right in this building across the way a little bit. And we had five different priests come to it. Father Cormier came to it. Father Cormier actually preached on it one Sunday, which was super. I mean, nobody in California has ever helped me as much as Father Cormier has helped me already. You know, I can tell you that right now. I mean, he's been great. But the point of this, the way we advertise is we said anyone who's been affected by family breakdown, we didn't ask people why or how or, you know, whatever. They didn't have to tell us anything particular. So what we did, this was the poster on the image here, was the poster that was all around town and stuff. Then what we did was ask people to think about one person to pray for and that they're particularly concerned about. And so we had them write that person's name down. And as we went through the little spiritual exercises and prayers, have people focus on that person and how you might speak with them, how you might interact with them to be supportive of them and bringing them closer to Christ, even though they may be way off the reservation. You know, I mean, because people are all over the place with this stuff. But the very first thing that we wanted people to know, and I'll share this with you, and then all these spaces here, that's where we had people write down any person's name who came to your mind, write it down. Okay, and so you can keep this, and you can do that. You know, anybody that comes to your mind, you guys, that has been harmed in any way by family breakdown, just jot their names down, tuck this in your prayer book, tuck this in your missal or whatever you carry around, and think of those persons when you're saying your prayer. So that's what this is for, so that's why I gave it to you. But we wanted to convey to people, it was not all your fault. And that's the main thing I want to convey to you. It was not all your fault. Every family in America has had these problems. It's not just your family or you being especially goofed up or irresponsible or crazy or something. No. We're all being barraged with all this untruth that was in that pamphlet, right? We're being barraged with it all the time. So we have to be gentle with ourselves and with one another as we go through this process. So we will be having another one of these retreats. Father Long has already agreed to put on another retreat over at Good Counsel for the college students, but I think it's open to anyone. All of my things are open to anyone. And then on the 17th of January, I'll be the speaker at the Respect Life Banquet, and I'll be giving a longer, more extensive presentation there, I suppose. But the point that I want to leave you guys with is that it is possible to rebuild the family. That is absolutely possible. And in fact, it's necessary. If we don't do something to rebuild the family, we're going to lose it. Almost 70% of people without a high school diploma, 70% of their children are born out of wedlock. Think about that. That is a huge debt that we're leaving hanging over those kids. We've got to do something about it. And I believe that rebirth can start right here in Lake Charles, Louisiana. At the end of the retreat, I gave everybody a little flag of Louisiana. Can you picture what's on the flag of Louisiana? Our pelican? Okay. The reason I gave everybody out that flag is that it's the only flag I know of that has a family on it. It has the mama and her three little chicks, right? And therefore, I think there is no reason at all why the renewal of the family cannot start right here in Lake Charles, Louisiana. And I invite all of you to be part of our mission. Thank you very much.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking on what work the Ruth Institute does to the Altar Society in Lake Charles, Louisiana. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.